sent by. Yeah, because she had to say all the names. Otherwise, people would be bent and twisted, right? That your name wasn't read. And that's never a good thing, is it? Well, good morning. He is risen. He is risen out of it. Hallelujah. Praise God. And we're going to talk about that today as well. But the first thing we're going to do is we're going to sing a little. Now, even though you're masked on, you can sing this no problem, right? Lord, I lift your name on high. Let's stand if you're able.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show
today in Jesus' precious name. Amen. 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 You may be seated, and we're going to read together. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 to 7. That is all about love. And today, more than anything else, is about love. Chapter 13 of 1 Corinthians chapter 4. Let's read this together. Love is patient. Love is kind. Is not jealous, does not brag, and is not arrogant, does not act unbecomingly, does not seek its own, is not provoked, does not take into account wrong suffered, does not rejoice in unrighteousness, but rejoices with the truth, bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Amen. Amen. Next week, thank you for those who came. It was great to see people out Friday for Easter evening concert, and it did go wonderfully well. It did. And I want to really thank Brian for, and I put it in there hours, and it was hours. It was three or four. It was a long time to disconnect across from the wall. I tell you, if the church was to fall down, the cross would still be sitting on that angle. It was never meant to come off, but we are determined. And then we got that up there. Lois, two trips into town on the same day. It's hard at Lois, looking for different lights, returning some, taking back. And then it was very interesting, wasn't it, Brian? Getting them on the back and getting that to work. But it's wonderful, and it's like it's always been up there. Just wonderful. So thank you. Thank you very much. Hosanna. We've got it on tape here, and I think this is where you get to take your hymnals out for a song. If you remember what they look like, they're in the pew in front of you. I know we normally put the words up on the screen. It is number three in your hymnal, right at the very beginning. Crown him with many crowns, and our Lord indeed needs to be and is crowned. Please. Oh, crank that puppy out. We're going to say, let's stand. If you can, remain seated if you need to. It's okay. Because he lives, as we prepare our hearts for prayer. God sent his Son, they called him Jesus. He came to love and forgive. He lived and died to place that we've consecrated and set aside for your purposes. We lift up this morning our brother Al and his beautiful wife Rana that are going through health crisis. And Father, we continue to ask for healing for both of them. We continue to ask for healing for Al's cancer, Lord. And you have called us to bring before you the big, the undoable, the impossible by any of our human standards, prayers and requests, Lord, to you, that who can do anything. For you're the creator of all that we see and hear, taste, touch, smell, and experience, Father. And so we ask and lift to you this prayer. And I believe, Father, as we lift our prayers to you today, that the power of your presence will come down upon the object of our prayer, and the blessings will flow back upon us, Lord. And so we lift to you in prayer. We praise you, Father. We praise you for what you've done in Ashley's life, that you brought her from the verge of death in this acute leukemia, Lord, and brought her into remission. And I know, Father, I know that the doctors might take credit for a lot of this, but I know that a lot of prayer has been lifted to you. And I know the healing balm, that healing power has flowed from the very gates of heaven upon her, Lord. Father, I want to pray for Carl's family today, and for Rana and all those in the family at the loss of this, at the loss of this man. And Lord, even though we may be prepared for something that might happen, when it arrives, it's always a shock. It's always a surprise. It always hurts deep in our hearts. And so, Father, I lift that entire family to you this morning, Lord, as they deal with the passing of someone that they loved and cared about. Father, I pray for those who are here today. I pray for those that that have come to this place today to be here on Easter morning to celebrate the risen Lord, to praise you for our life, the life abundant and life eternal, Lord. I thank you for all those who come, and I ask a blessing be poured upon their lives. I pray for those who couldn't make it here today for whatever reason, Lord, that you be with them, that wherever they sit, wherever they stand, wherever they lie, Lord, that they know that they're loved, not just by you, but by each and every one of us. Father, I pray for this COVID. I pray for this pandemic that's taken so many countless lives across the planet, that you would bring this to an end, that you would bring calmer and wiser heads to prevail, Lord, to do what we need to do to put this behind us and get on with the rest of our lives. Father, I ask that you bless this message today, this Easter message, and that people not hear my words or my thoughts or my actions or my illustrations, Lord, but that they hear you, the Holy Spirit. You will speak into their hearts today so that they will leave here with what you want them to know. And I will thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Sang a song the other day, or Friday night, and a beautiful song of Easter, and I'd like to do that again.
Hallelujah.
To Jesus. as he took our sins on, as he bore them, the Father could not gaze upon the evil that he was in that moment, and he felt forsaken. Then, about the ninth hour, about 3 p.m, again, he died. And when he died, the curtain in the temple was rent from top to bottom. It was torn from top to bottom to open up the path so that we might have access to God. So that that barrier that became between us and God, that barrier that meant that we had to go through the priest, through the high priest, in the Holy of Holies, just to get to God, was removed, and we had direct access to God. All we had to do, the Bible says, is declare with our mouth that Jesus is Lord of our lives, and believe in our hearts that God the Father sent him to live and to die, that he died on a cross, that he took our sins to the cross, that he took them to the grave, and he left them there, and then he was resurrected and sits alive at the right hand of the Father, that we might have life abundant and we might have life eternal. A veil, an elaborately woven fabric, 72 twisted pairs of 24 threads, 60 or 70 feet tall, 30 feet wide. Yet, by itself, by the hand of God, this thing was torn open so that we could gaze upon the face of God. Jesus said that he would go to the depths and he would rise again in 3 days. And we saw that with Lazarus, did we not? Mary and Martha pleaded with him, come home, come home. Lazarus is sick, but he stayed away. Lazarus died, he stayed away. 3 days he stayed away, more than 3 days before he came back. Why? Because the belief in that time was that any doctor, any priest, any holy person could bring someone back to life if they were dead for only 3 days. But after 3 days, only God could bring you back to life. And when he brought Lazarus back to life, he put the final nail in the coffin for himself, because he declared in that action that he was God. Now, having declared that, he further told them that if you destroy this temple, I'll come back in 3 days. And some of us may think, well, Friday afternoon to Sunday morning doesn't really make 3 days. How does that make any sense? But in the Jewish world, the way that they looked at things, any part of a day was considered a day. And so when he died at 3 p.m, he had to be in the ground before 6 o'clock, because the Sabbath was there, 1 day. 6 o'clock in the evening to 6 o'clock Saturday night, 2 days. And when he came back to life, when he was resurrected that morning, on Sunday morning, 3 days that he would come back. We read in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 27. Verses 62 to 66. These words, and if you're using your own scriptures, we're going to be in Matthew a little bit. Matthew 27, 62 to 66. Now on the next day, the day after the preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered together with Pilate and said, Sir, we remember that when he was still alive, that the deceiver said, after 3 days, I'm to rise again. Therefore, give orders for the grave to be made secure until the third day. Otherwise, his disciples may come and steal him. Steal him away to the people. And he has risen from the dead, and the last deception will be worse than the first. Pilate said to them, You have a guard. Go make it secure as you know how. And they went and made the grave secure. And along with the guard, they set a seal on the stone. Now this is Saturday. This is Saturday. Saturday began 6 o'clock Friday night, Saturday. And they said, we want you to go and we want you to seal the grave. We want you to do that. We want to make sure no one steals this Jesus away. No one takes the body of Yeshua ben Joseph out of the grave and hide somewhere so it would look like he actually came back to life after 3 days. How did they do that? They had to go and to the grave itself, and because this was a Roman seal, because this was official, they had to look inside. And so I'm sure they would have moved the stone one last time themselves, taken a peek in to make sure the body was still there, rolled it back again, drove iron pins on both sides, draped a rope across it, and with wax placed the seal of the governor of the area so that no one would get in. And the Roman soldiers, not the temple police, but the Roman soldiers would have stood there. Now, how would they have done that? They would have had to guard him by standing across the face of the grave every 3 feet. And they would take turns throughout the days. And this was the penalty when they were doing this. If a Roman soldier fell asleep, the penalty was death. But not just for that soldier, for the entire group that had gathered there. They would all die. And so they made sure that everyone stayed awake the whole time. And yet, although that was done to make sure that to disprove what Jesus had said, actually that was extra witnesses to what Jesus actually did. It was marvelous. They would have done that in the same way, perhaps, that Daniel was put in the lion's den. We read about it in Daniel chapter 6 and 16 to 18. Then the king gave orders, and Daniel was brought in and cast into the lion's den. The king spoke and said to Daniel, "Your God, whom you constantly serve, will himself deliver you." A stone was brought and laid over the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it in with his own signet ring and with the signet rings of his nobles, so that nothing would be changed in regard to Daniel. Then the king went off to his place and spent the night fasting. No entertainment was brought before him, and his sleep fled before him. The sealing was done in the presence of the Roman guard who were left in charge to protect this stamp of Roman authority and power at the tomb of Jesus. Then came Sunday. Then came Sunday. Friday he's on the cross. Saturday he's in the grave. And Sunday, again, the Gospel of Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 to 10. Now after the Sabbath, as it began to dawn towards the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to look at the grave. And behold, a severe earthquake had occurred. For an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled away the stone and sat up on it. And his appearance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. Then the guards shook with fear of him and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you're looking for Jesus who has been crucified. He's not here. He's not here. For he has risen, just as he said. Come see the place where he was lying. Go quickly and tell the disciples that he had risen from the dead. And behold, he's going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you." And they left the tomb quickly with fear and great joy, and ran to report it to his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and greeted them. And they came up and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. And Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and take word to my brethren and leave for Galilee, and there they will see me." So many things happened that morning. When was the stone rolled away? They prepared before light to go and anoint Jesus. The stone was rolled away in the dark before the dawn. Was it rolled away at 1 minute after six on Saturday? That would have been the third day. Was it rolled away in the middle of the night at midnight, or halfway in the morning? Was it rolled away just before the women came? The Roman guards were frozen. Some fled, some sick, some worshiping as the earthquake moved that stone. Time is a funny thing for us today, is it not? We like our time to be right down to the nanosecond.
They have something called an atomic clock. You can look it up online if you want, and it will tell you almost to the nanosecond what the exact time is. In our house, we have clocks everywhere. We have a clock in the bathroom. Ticks away. We have a clock in the living room. TV has a clock, right? Watch, phone. There's a clock in the kitchen, on the microwave, on the stove itself, in the sewing room. The time is everywhere. Time upstairs. We are obsessed with time, about exactness of time. But in the ancient world, they were not. They were not. It's still like that in Africa. I remember sitting at the airport waiting for an airplane in Accra. I was going to fly north to Tamale. The plane was supposed to arrive at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. They took the chicken lunch and put it on the heat. It was at 100 degrees in the shade. The plane never came. An hour later, the plane never came. An hour and a half after the scheduled time of departure, the plane showed up. I did not eat the chicken sandwich on the flight north. Time was no big deal. As they were going internationally, the time was bang on. They left on time, they came on time. But all flights and all travel within the country, get to it when we get to it. We'll get there, right? And so back in those days, time was a little looser than the time is today. So if you take all of the Gospels and take a look at the time, in essence, of what happened that day, you will discover something. You will get a bigger picture. Time is this. Very early in the morning, a group of several women arrived, including Mary Magdalene, approached the tomb to complete the burial custom on behalf of Jesus. Then they beheld the tomb that was opened, and they were alarmed. Mary Magdalene runs to Peter and John with distressing news. There's grave robbers. Someone has stolen the Lord. The women who remain encounter an angel who declares to them that Jesus has risen and that they should go tell the brethren. They're filled with fear at first and depart the tomb, afraid to speak a word. But recovering their courage, they decide to go to the apostles. Meanwhile, Peter and John have gone out to the tomb to investigate Mary's claim. Mary Magdalene followed them back onto the tomb, arriving before they left. Peter and John discovered the empty tomb. They encountered no angel. John believes in the resurrection. Peter, I don't know what he felt. His conclusion was not left for us in the scriptures. The other women have reported the angel said to the apostles, Peter and John have not yet returned, and these remaining apostles are dismissive of the women's story at first. The other women, Mary, lingering at the tomb, weeps and is fearful. Peering into the tomb, she sees two angels and wonders, and they wonder why is she weeping. Jesus approaches her from behind, but not looking directly at him, she thinks it's the garden keeper, the caretaker of this land. He says, Mary, he calls her by name. She recognizes that name and turns and sees him. Filled with joy, she clings to him. Jesus sends her back to the apostles with the news to prepare for his appearance later that day. The women have departed, and the apostles are on their way back home, maybe. Jesus appears to them after they dispatch Mary. Also, he sends them back to the apostles with the news, the good news, that he has risen and that he would see them. We grapple with time, do we not? We worry about the when and the why and the who and the how. If we go back to the book of Genesis, you will see online millions of articles about when the earth was created, how long it took to create, and how it was done. Does it really matter? Some of you may say it was done in six literal days, and the seventh day God rested, right? Some of you may say, as the ancient Hebrew script says, time period. So there's 6 or 7 time periods. How long is that? 1 million years? 1 billion years? I don't know. Is it important? No.
It's not important how it was done. It's not important when it was done. What is important is the who and the why. The who was God, and the why was us, humanity, to come into a relationship, to have some communion with each other, to have someone to love and someone to cherish. And what about Revelation? The same thing. Millions of articles and books are written about the when and the how of what we read in the book of Revelation. When is the end going to come? How is it going to come? How is it going to take place? What's going to happen? Again, does it matter? No, it doesn't. The Bible says that the hour and time that God will come, that Jesus will come again, is not known. He will come like a thief in the night. Oh, we as Christians, as followers of Yeshua, will have an idea that it's coming, but we will not know. Does it matter? No. Does it matter what heaven's going to look like? No. You close your eyes this side of heaven and wake up in heaven, you won't care what heaven looks like. What's important is the who and the why. The who is God, but Jesus Christ as God. And the why is to bring us back to that place, to recreate what was lost in the garden when Adam and Hava, or Adam and Eve, sinned that day. To bring us back, to give us life eternal. What happened Easter morning? How was he resurrected? When exactly did it happen? 1 minute after six? Or just before the sun rose? In the middle of the night? When did the earthquake happen? When did the angels come? When was the boulder rolled away? Who cares? Who cares? Jesus is risen to give us abundant life and life eternal. What's important is the who and the why. The who is God. But not just God, God in three persons. One essence, three persons, the Trinity that we read throughout Scripture. The first person who raised Jesus from the dead was God the Father. He brought Jesus back to life. We read it in the gospel, or in the book of Acts, chapter 2 and 32 and 33. This Jesus God raised up again. This Jesus God raised up again, to which we are all witness. Therefore, having been exalted to the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he's poured forth this which you both see and hear. Jesus brought himself back from the grave. Gospel of John, chapter 2, verses 18 and 19. The Jews said to him, "What sign do you show us as an authority for doing these things?" And Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple," he's pointing to himself, "and in 3 days, what? I will raise it up." The Holy Spirit raised Jesus up. Romans chapter 8 and verse 11. "But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you." God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit raised Jesus from the dead. Not from hell, because no one's in hell yet. They're from Sheol, right? From that place that people go to await the judgment. If they're not going to heaven. But when Jesus died and was risen, he took the captives free. So that now when anyone passes away, as Paul says, when we get rid of this, cast away this earthly tent, we're given a new body, not made by earthly hands, but of heavenly hands, we will go to heaven. And if you've said the words that you believe Jesus is King, and you believe in your heart that God sent him to die, you will be there as well one day. And will you recognize those that have gone on before because they will have a temporary body because they'll get rid of this one? Absolutely! If I were to hold up a pumpkin seed, You would know what that seed would grow into. If I planted it and let it grow, it would grow into a great pumpkin. And so, if I see the seed here, and I see the pumpkin there, it's the same thing. Whenever we are here, whenever we become there, it's the same thing. When you go, people will recognize you. You will recognize those who have gone on before. Now the question is, why? Why did the resurrection happen? And the why is you. The why is me. Listen to this poem by Vaughn Featherstone. Listen to the words carefully. The day grew dark and dreary. The earth a shudder gave. The temple veil was rent in twain. The elements did rave. A torn and bruised and battered body hung on a lonely cross, while blood and sweat with holy tears before witness of the loss. Brutal man with evil thorns beckoned his head with crown. Crude soldiers bartered his robe, still others kneeled down. Some friends stood beneath the cross while others stood afar. The door of death was near at hand, resurrection's door ajar. Evil and vicious men rejoiced. Holy men in sorrow bowed. The Father of Spirit had withdrawn as if behind a shroud. With vinegar and gall they ministered. Nor friends did intercede, they pierced his side with sharpened sword, an ugly final deed. Beyond all pain, his body hung, the Son of God was dead. Disciples wept in silence, his blood was scarlet red. But rise again, he promised, and rise again he did. All he had been commanded, all his Father bid, withholding not, nor pride, nor pain, nor even life, nor spared, nor glory did he ever seek, nor was his suffering shared. The resurrected Christ, the risen Lord, our King of Kings and God, for all will follow him, will find resurrection's path that he trod. Why did Jesus die? Jesus died for you. Jesus died for you. Father, we thank you, Lord, for these words. We thank you for the visual. We thank you, Lord, for your sacrifice. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your sacrifice. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for your sacrifice. Touch us deeply this day. Show us the path. Reveal to us. Make it a reality for us today. Not only take us to the foot of the cross to smell and hear and taste and touch and feel and experience, but take us then to the open tomb to taste and smell and hear and see and experience freedom from death. Oh, death, where is your sting? It is gone. Thank you, Father, for this. Pour into each person here that thought, that idea, that notion, that hope, that truth, Lord, that they might leave here knowing what Sunday is all about, what the risen Lord means for them. It means freedom from death. And we praise you for this and so much more in Jesus' name. Amen. We are saved by the incredible grace of God. And we're going to sing that right now. Amazing grace. Our chains are gone. Who did it? God did it. Why did God do it? For you and for me. Our chains are gone. Let us stand if we're able.
Amazing grace.
shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun will be teaching shine, but God above, because we will be forever.
Don't eat too much chocolate.
It's a compliment from the lion.